Welcome to the Information Security Forum podcast. I'm your host, Tavia Gilbert, and today's episode is the second and last featuring ISF Managing Director Steve Durbin's interview with Emory Craig, educator and leading expert in augmented and virtual reality. Today, we'll be delving into the ethical concerns related to this new technology.
The big controversy at Google now with the Project Maven, the employees signing a petition saying don't work with the Department of Defense on this because what you're doing is taking personal data and then processing it through AI. And yeah, we'll probably reach the point where we make our kill decisions based on algorithms as opposed to people, which is incredibly frightening.
Yeah, absolutely. And how do you implement a safety switch in all of that?
I don't know that there's any easy way to do that. I mean, this is one of the things we have to work out as we go into this. And that's, you know, in the same kind of way that we have to work it out just in virtual reality itself, because virtual experiences seem so real. But where do you pull back and say this is, you know, that's fake? We do have to implement some kind of safety switch. But, yeah, you know, it's going to require all of us being a lot more cognizant of the issues than we are right now.
Yeah. And what are some of the steps you think we ought to take? I mean, you know, one of the things that clearly is important is the responsible handling of that. Mm-hmm. And I think if we look at some of the ways in which legislation has been introduced, for instance, of late around things like, you know, personal data, and it's in catch-up mode. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that strikes me about this is that it probably isn't an area where we want to play catch-up. We probably do want to try to set some ground rules at the beginning. Just my view. I mean, would you agree?
I would agree. I'm not sure that we will.
Right.
You know, yeah. But I think we should. But sometimes my darker side here goes, no, we're going to do the same model that we've done with social media, which is mistakes are made, apologies are offered, and then we continue. And you look back on Facebook now, it's been a 15-year apology tour from his early days at a dorm room of, you know, apologizing before a student government group. And, you know, we may continue that way. And I don't know. But we do have to try to get ahead of the curve on this. And that means people trying VR, but beginning, not just trying it, beginning to understand the issues involved in it. And that's kind of one of the things that my colleague and I, Maya Chirjeeva, really thought about when we founded Digital Bodies, because we're not making equipment, we're not creating experiences. We want to go into that space of how is this going to get used? What is the impact on businesses, organizations, higher education institutions, even K through 12? Mm-hmm. And everybody is starting to struggle with this now as they deal with this. It's a lot of fun to do something. It's incredibly powerful because it puts you right there. But there's all sorts of consequences surrounding this that are related to this that we really have to be aware of.
Is there any entity that is leading the charge in answering some of these questions of what is the responsible application or what are the...
We're working on it. I know there's a code of ethics that's been floated around in Europe right now coming out of a university there on doing research in VR. There's some other initiatives, but I think many are just getting started on this because everybody's still at the basic level of, oh, I need to try this or I've tried this and now I need to try something else. And we're at this stage. Janet Murray Hamlin on a holodeck, very, very famous piece on cyberspace in general, where she says the challenge now is that it's still so new that it's hard to distinguish the good from the bad. Mm-hmm. We just get caught up in the novelty of it. What we need to do is get beyond the novelty of it, you know, begin to understand what works here, what is good and what's not.
Yeah. I think for me, one of the interesting things that came out of the whole Facebook piece that we've been watching being played out over the last few, you know, weeks or months or years even, is, for me anyway, it's an example of an organization that is continually trying to push forward. It's continually trying to break boundaries. And yet one of the things that it hasn't been able to do is to keep pace with the way in which society might have changed. So our reaction to use of information.
Right.
And it seems to me that when we look at things like VR, and this is what was behind my question about, you know, should we be legislating before
or after?
You know, Zuckerberg's view on that legislation is inevitable, it's simply a question of what that legislation might look like, is one answer to it. And I think it's probably the same with VR. But are there not some things that we could be putting in place, some guidelines, some approaches that would enable companies that are inevitably going to be springing up, because it is a huge commercial opportunity, let's face it, to at least provide some kind of guideline or means of measuring, containing what it is they get up to?
I think we will. I don't know if we're in a position to do it now. One thing that's going to help trigger this is AR.
Right.
Because once you get augmented reality, it's going to, as soon as we get the glasses, we're not there yet, we have it on our phones, but it's even more rudimentary than a VR right now, but it's really taking off. And of course, all the rumors of Apple coming up with a pair of AR glasses. Once you have that, you're going to be in a situation of having virtual augmented environments everywhere, including out on the streets, in businesses. And I think when that happens, I think that's going to trigger a real response to, we have to somehow manage this. Because, I mean, we do right now. You walk down the streets of New York City and, you know, you right, you're on your phone. But we also don't realize that signage is regulated in the city very, very strictly in terms of where you can put a sign, how bright it can be, how large it can be with a storefront and like that. Once you have AR, it's just going to be simply everywhere. Businesses, for example, do you somehow try to regulate employees can't make comments on the wall and leave it hanging on the wall virtually of the company or the CEO or something like that? You know, what do you do? And restaurants, do you really want to be bombarded by offers to come in out on the sidewalk? It's one thing to stop and look at a menu to see the sign. It's another thing to be walking along minding your own business and having something interfere with your personal space. I think with AR, we're going to see a real push to regulate it. And, you know, right now with the VR, so much of it has been at the very beginning. And, you know, there's been some big mistakes made already, but it's, you know, it's kind of where it is. And I think it's going to be hard for someone to do more than, say, recommendations on what we should do. And a lot of the learning that's gone on right now has been from people trying things that work and experimenting and trying other things that didn't work. Mm-hmm. To give you a good favorite example of mine, some years ago, Knott's Berry Farm out in California, they do this thing called Scary Farm in the fall. It's 4 to 6 weeks of live actors in character and all sorts of wonderful things around Halloween. In 2016, they got the bright idea to do a VR experience and did something called Scary VR, where they strapped people into a fake wheelchair, put a VR headset on them, but it was on a vibrating floor, so you thought you were moving. And next thing you knew, you were being wheeled through a mental health facility where the patients were starting to go berserk and attack you. And you can imagine the reaction of mental health professionals. You just went decades of work to kind of humanize what is such a difficult experience. And you, in a process of a 10-minute experience, suddenly just upended this completely. And they scaled it down, they toned it down, and then eventually they had to cancel it in the middle of it. And then, of course, what was interesting, the debate we had, and it was a kind of a public debate, petitions started, and there had already been petitions to cancel this. It was canceled in the middle of that Halloween season. And then other people said, but hey, it's just a Halloween experience. There's 200 movies on the, you know, internet movie database that are set into mental health facility. What's wrong with this? Well, what's wrong with it is it crossed the line, because you weren't watching something on a screen. You were there.
Participating.
You were participating in VR, and that's what is different about VR, is that it hijacks your senses. And that's what we kind of have to puzzle out here and come to grips with, is that this is not a traditional media. This is a media. Traditional media, you have to have a suspension of disbelief. You have to be willing to go, I'm not looking at a screen. I'm getting immersed in a story. VR, as Chris Melk says from within, you constantly have to step out of it and remind yourself, no, that was not real. And that's the real challenge here. And the following year, 2017, Knott's Berry Farm did something very different. It was a ghost town VR experience where you're just shooting ghosts. Nice, safe, not a big deal. But, you know, and, you know, some of these things, I think we have to kind of go through this, because you're right. I think there's an urge here to try to manage this to some degree, but we're not quite sure what the line is until it's crossed. And when you cross the line, then you go, okay, that's no, we shouldn't do that. And then maybe you say after that, you manage it. But then what every single VR experience, depending on how, not just the topic, depending on how it's designed, the intensity of it can be different. And it's going to be the intensity factor that I think that is critical in this, because if there's enough distance from it, then you might say, okay, I can handle this and understand it, where if it gets too intense, Animal Equity did a short little 360 video a couple years ago, which they showed at Davos, called iAnimal, and it put you in a slaughterhouse. And, you know, there were people that came out of that after 5 minutes and said, that did it for me for meat eating. I'm done. You know, I'm vegan now. But there were others who were outraged and said, you should not have put me into that without telling me in advance what you were doing, because I can't undo what I saw. You know, I've seen this now, and I can't get it out of my head. Yeah. And it's that kind of thing that we're going to have to grapple with here. And, well, I mean, the obvious thing that comes out of this, okay, you have a rating system like we do with games. And But how do we rate our games? We rate them on language and sexual suggestiveness or something like that, or nudity. With VR, you'd need something much different than that. It would have to be a rating system maybe based on the intensity of the experience. And, we don't have any easy parameters for dealing with that right now.
And presumably, Emory, different people will react in different ways to that experience.
That will. And then you get into, well, why are you regulating this? Because I'm just fine with it. I don't have a problem. But, you know, somebody else does. And, you know, we, for example, in our work digital bodies, we particularly get this question a lot when we do work with, say, middle schools and high schools. We question, first of all, what age should kids start using VR? But the question of what do I do about an experience that's intense? And we're going to get this across the board, because it's one thing to read about the slaughterhouse. It's another thing even to see the documentary film on it. It's a whole different experience to step into it, even a 360 video, and look down and see the blood running past your shoe floor. You know. So for some people, it might not bother them, and they may say, I do want that experience. And others are going to say, no, I can't. I don't want that. It's going to be very tough to kind of regulate in a way that's fair to the diversity of the population of human experience in general. So
It's interesting what you're saying about what I'm thinking is the implications in this very contemporary time when we are struggling with holding on to what's true, what's real, that if people are in these augmented reality, virtual reality experiences, to them, because they are feeling something intensely, it is real. So it seems like there's a lot of potential for manipulation, even beyond what we're already dealing with, of the truth, or representing something as true, real, factual, when in fact it is the antithesis.
You're absolutely right on that. You know, one of my big concerns here is we've all seen over the past year the rise of fake news. And, you know, if you go back 3 or 4 years, you'd be like, nobody was thinking about fake news in social media. We just wouldn't think that it could be misused or that a foreign government might use it as a way to influence an election. And now we're going to go from fake news to fake realities.
Mm. Right.
And, you know, it's a lot of the documentary work, all the documentary work that I've seen has been done with people with the best intentions, whether it's this is climate change or, you know, clouds over Sidra, the New York Times with its series, The Displaced, on, you know, children living in war-torn areas and on. And everybody's got, you know, the goodness in their heart and they're trying to do this right. Mm-hmm. But the tools are going to get easier to use. And as the tools get easier, as with social media, as the tools get easier, it becomes easier now to do the fake news and very soon to do the fake reality. And what happens when that is juxtaposed to the good? You know, here's the good version, for example, of gender relationships, of, you know, what we should do in racial issues. And here's the whole other side. And somebody posts this and puts it up with evil intent. Mm-hmm. And, we're going to really have to come to terms with this, because we will have fake realities out there. And, you know, just as right now people can cite fake news and say, even a fake news. Look at the thing with the guy with the pizza thing in Washington, D.C. Right. Around the last election, and a supposed child sex ring or something like that. If a fake news article can do that, imagine what a fake reality will be able to do. As I always say to people, I just think that we're, as much as I kind of wake up, and I'm sure we all do every day, kind of wide-eyed, what's the latest? You know, let's look at the news and see what's happened today. I'm just kind of going, the issues we're dealing with right now, 5 to 10 years from now, are going to seem like child's play. We're going to be in a such more difficult time. That said, I have to add to that to say that, you know, every technology has a dystopian element to it. And I don't want to push that dystopian side, because you can go back and look at the history of the railroads in the 1830s, and there was people who said this is a dystopian future for us in this. And it was in some respects, you know, in terms of what it did of upending location and, you know, getting people to travel more, lane of travel. So I don't want to say that it's negative. I just say that we really are going to have to deal with these issues. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's the kind of thing where we need to try to be ahead of the curve here, not just playing catch up on this.
Thanks for listening to our two-part conversation between ISF Managing Director Steve Durbin and educator Emory Craig. We leave today's episode with more questions than answers, but we do hope you're leaving with some more information and a lot of food for thought. New episodes will be released soon, with Steve in conversation with entrepreneurs, law enforcement, journalists, and more. For more resources and episodes, visit securityforum.org.